Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. After Prophet Idris, salamullah alayhi, slowly idol worship crept into the human community. Now the story there, according to the hadith, is there used to be renowned people within the community after Prophet Idris, by the name of Wad, Su'a, Ya'uq, Ya'guth, and Nasr, and other many prominent people. Wad appears to be an extremely good, pious, wise person, who was very prominent within the community of the time. Now, when he died, people began to miss him and they began to grieve over him. At that point, somebody was whispered to by the devil or the shaitan that if you miss Wad so much, why don't you construct an idol, a statue of Wad, so that you can feel his presence in the place in which he sat. According to another set of hadith, Shaitan himself came and he said to those people that you miss Wad so much and he was so prominent, why don't I create for you a statue of Wad? Now, before we go into this, the Quran talks of Shaitan as a very different reality to Iblis. For example, Allah says, Shayateen al-Jinni wal-Ins. The Shaitan, plural Shayateen is the plural of Shaitan, amongst man and jinn. The Prophet had said that I have conquered my shaitan. And the first Imam had said that the biggest shaitan for a human being is his own soul. So Iblis is a portion of shaitan. Shaitan is anything that is wayward or away from righteousness and away from godliness or God-centricity. Those people allowed Iblis or shaitan, or they were whispered to, or they entertained this thought, and then they created a statue. And then it occurred to them that why don't we create the statue of Wad in every household so we can feel the presence of Wad everywhere. Then they created statues of Wad in their houses and they used to venerate those statues, but only as a gesture of respect. They were not worshipping it. But as the generations passed, the generations that came, it occurred to them, it is said that the shaitan whispered to them, but it occurred to them that these were the gods that our forefathers worshipped. And then they began to worship these idols. Now the problem in idol worship is that idol worship removes the person from the lofty goals that are destined for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that I extracted a pledge from you, am I not your God? And we said, yes. He said, at least on the day of Qiyamah, you come to me and you say, our forefathers did this, why do you chastise us for it? We had no knowledge of it. So here, the verse is implying that the knowledge of idolatry being wrong is either always passed down generation to generation through the godly messages and through the prophets of God. So it is something that is known. Or that the inner being itself suggests that God cannot be confined to these statues. Indeed, in the story of Ibrahim, we find that people actually worshipped statues. They did not put the statues as means to God. They worshipped those statues. And in the story of Israelites as well, we find that the Israelites worshipped the calf. And when they passed upon a village who were worshipping an idol, they said to Moses, make us a god like they have a god. So those people in their very primitive understanding did not make idols a means of worshipping God. Even that is something that the Quran does not accept. But they worshipped the idol per se as if the idol was God. Now the problem there is that the idolatry or any movement away from God is movement away from truest form of intellectual, moral and spiritual liberation and freedom. Imam Ali indicates that Lat and Uzza, the wood and stone that the Meccans used to worship, carried the values that the Meccans gave to them of social exploitation, immorality, moral degradation, intellectual captivity, so on and so forth. These were the values through which they lived, And then those idols portrayed those values for them, the class systems, the status quo, so on and so forth. So actually these idols were a result of human beings on wayward desire or wayward thinking. And then it was projected onto the idols and then perpetuated through the worship of the idols. And then the excuse was that these idols, which are our God, ordained this. Similarly, we find in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala often says that their idols or their shaitan or their gods ordained them to kill little children, or they sacrifice children for their idols. Almost to say that their own wayward thinking was promoted onto their idols and then received from the idols in an indirect way and then became something that was sacred and divine. We must be very, very careful of anything that is placed in place of veneration that we honor, lest it leads to stagnation of the mind, or that it takes us away from reliance upon Allah, or that it takes us to the reliance upon other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for these are all movements towards the same end, that is taking human beings away from their completion. Now, after idolatry took hold of the human community, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commissioned Nuh to go to his people and to preach to them. In hadith, we are told that Hazrat Nuh lived for 2,500 years. When he was 850 years old, he was told to go to those people. The Quran at some points depicts him as the brother. Their brother Nuh told them. This could mean that maybe they were from the same clan and from the same root and from the same family. And indeed that makes sense because they were all children of Adam, and Nuh came 1,000 years after Nabi Idris. So it wasn't very long after Adam, and maybe it is right to use that word, their brother. Similarly, the prophets that came after Nuh, like Nabi Hud, Nabi Saleh, they were called brothers. Nabi Nuh preached to them. Now, when Nabi Nuh preached to them, Nabi Nuh himself had not worshipped idols because he was enlightened, very spiritually liberated, intellectually open. He could think beyond these things and was not confined by these thoughts. Those people found it extremely strange. But when Nabi Nuh persisted in his message, the people who were deemed to be weak and poor started following the message of Nabi Nuh. Now, this immediately suggests to us that the society had class distinctions, the strong and the weak. The strong were known as the learned ones, whereas the weak were known as the foolish. And we see this in the Quran, that the people of Nabi Nuh said to him, "Why should we follow you when only the weak, the meek, and the foolish amongst us follow you?" In order to discredit Nabi Nuh's message that if you had been of any worth, we would have followed you instead. And we see this in today's world as well. We judge a message by the people who follow that message rather than looking at the message for what it is worth. So in an Islamophobic world, a non-Muslim would say, "Why should we follow Islam when all these awful people are following Islam?" Without thinking that there are 1.7 billion plus people following Islam, and these wayward extremists are only a minor portion. So surely Islam must have more to it than what these people are understanding from Islam. Nonetheless, we do the same. I remember in the early 80s, we the Muslims would reject everything that came from the West because it was non-Muslim. But we never had the tawfiq, or we never had the sense of looking into what the West was saying for what it was worth within itself. Just because it came from the West, we rejected it. It's a human tendency. Those people who are intellectually liberated would look into the content of what is being said beyond who is saying it and who is following it.
إِيمَانٍ.